parts of the Agile ecosystem or the engineering practices around agility. I think we've solved a lot of problems in the Agile space around project and process and estimation, but there's still a lot of area for improvement and sophistication on the engineering practices. And this is probably the most advanced of the engineering practices, is how do you do emergent design for real on projects. Now, some of you may have come to my talk a couple of days ago on rapid emergence, the long-term effects of this, and these talks are kind of backwards because this one is basically how to do these techniques, and that talk was kind of the implications of that. But Naresh wanted that as part of the management conference and wanted this as part of the technical conference, and so that's why they ended up the way they did. So I'll be talking about emergent design this morning. There is an article series that I've written under the heading of Evolutionary Architecture and Emergent Design on IBM Developer Works. These are free articles. You can go download, read them to your heart's content. There are 19 installments here. There's a link there that gives you the basic table of contents of all of those. That's hideous and awful, and so I've improved that with technology. There's a bit.ly link that you can follow, and that's basically the things I talk about here and a few other things in more detail. My agenda for this morning is to first kind of tease out what is software design and do a proper comparison between software engineering and other kinds of engineering. I want to talk about the distinctions between architecture and design. Then I want to talk about things that make emergent design hard, things that make it easier, and then some details about how to take advantage of these things once you've found them. But I'm going to start with the poetry of Donald Rumsfeld, who was a famous defense secretary in the U.S. for a while, and he very famously said at one point, "There are known unknowns. That is to say, there are things we now know we don't know, but there are also unknown unknowns. There are things we do not know that we don't know." It turns out he was talking about software here. And this is the really deadly thing in software. It's not the known unknowns, because you can plan for those. You know, we got to have security, and I don't know the details, but we can do some planning for that. It's the unknown unknowns that always nab you in software. It's the things you didn't even know that you had to plan for up front. And this is the thing that really poisoned the idea of big design up front in software. It always fails because of these unknown unknowns that you cannot possibly anticipate. It turns out that this is really just a reflection of a much broader principle, and that is that the future is very, very hard to predict. And that's exactly what you're doing if you embark on a gigantic architecture exercise before you've tried to start solving any part of the problem. You're trying to predict the future in all these myriad details that you've got no chance of getting exactly right, or in some cases, not even getting all that close. So I'm going to talk a lot about software design in this talk, and so we should probably do a real definition. So I'd really like to answer this question. What is software design? Fortunately, someone has already answered this question for us. In an essay published by Jack Reeves in the fall of 1992 in the C++ Journal, Jack Reeves wrote a famous essay called "What is Software Design?" It is still available. It's still worth reading. You would believe that it was written last week because it's still very, very accurate in what he talks about. And in this essay, he tries to do a proper comparison between traditional engineering and software engineering. Now, we have a lot of really shallow comparisons between these about bridge building and buildings and gardening and mountain climbing and all these metaphors. What he wanted to do is try to do a deeper comparison between these two styles of engineering. And he reached a really interesting conclusion as part of his essay, that the final goal of any engineering activity is some type of documentation. If you're a civil engineer and you are tasked with building a new bridge over here, what is your deliverable for that work? Is it the bridge? No. It's the plan for how to build a bridge at this location with these constraints, with this scalability, and you will turn that over to a team of expert bridge builders who will actually pour concrete with rebar and make that bridge a reality. Once the design effort is complete, the design documentation is turned over to the manufacturing team, and they manufacture it. Now, they have a little bit of feedback with the original civil engineer, but mostly this is a one-direction trade-off. But But this is one of the places where we see a stark difference between traditional engineering and software engineering, because manufacturing for physical things means you are stamping out atoms. And it turns out that atoms are relatively hard to reconfigure once you've got them stamped in a particular shape. In other words, refactoring physical things is hard. And so there's a really strong desire to get exactly right up front before you start stamping it into atoms, because it's really hard to fix after that. But we don't deal with atoms in the software world. We deal with bits. It turns out that bits are very malleable. You can change them at any time you want. They're very, very soft rather than hard. But now you have to ask yourself the question, if the final effort of design is documentation and it gets turned over to a manufacturing team, then who's the manufacturing team in software? What's the part of the software process that takes something and makes it manifest things in the real world, move electrons through wires and access networks and all those things? In software, our manufacturing process is compilation and deployment. So if that's the case, then what is our design document? It turns out our design document, our blueprint, is the source code, the complete source code for the project. Because if you make a change to one line of the source code, you have to remanufacture the whole thing. But here's a real difference between traditional engineering and software engineering. Because in traditional engineering, stamping out atoms and manufacturing things is very, very expensive. In fact, one of the reasons that civil engineering became an engineering discipline was not to build safer bridges. It was because it's too expensive to build a bridge and roll heavy stuff over it to see if it collapses or not to determine if it's a good bridge or not. And so they built up a lot of engineering techniques around mathematics and other sorts of predictive abilities so they didn't have to build a thing because it's so expensive to manufacture things. But in software, our design is cheap. We can make changes to it anytime we want. And it doesn't have that same kind of negative downstream impact that traditional engineering has. And so Jack Reese says that given that software designs are relatively easy to turn out and essentially free to build, an unsurprising revelation is that software designs tend to be incredibly large and complex. I think they're the most complex things created by humans right now in a lot of ways, because they're also very unlike other kinds of engineering in that, for example, our tolerances are impossibly small compared to other engineering disciplines. Let me give you an example of that. Let's say that this hotel, this big, nice, beautiful hotel, let's say that arbitrarily it took 200 people a year to build this place. I don't know what it actually is, but let's just say that. And imagine a piece of software that it would take 200 people a year to build. Now in this building, on the light, on the electrical socket on the wall, if they didn't get it completely covered, if they didn't completely cover the hole in the wall, the building won't fall down. But if you make a similarly small mistake in a piece of software, it will collapse and stop working. It will fail. Now, of course, you can spackle in that hole and remanufacture the whole thing almost instantly, but our tolerances are impossibly small compared to physical things. Forensic engineers, when there's a problem with an airplane wing, a wing falls off an airplane, they typically go to where the wing was attached to the airplane and start looking for problems. But for us, we can have something that creates a little instability here that doesn't manifest for 200,000 lines of code further down the line. We don't have the same locality of problem that traditional engineering often has, where the stress point is the part that's broken, because instabilities can be created in other places. We also don't have the same kind of economy of scale that traditional engineers have. Rivets in it. And you can bet that people who understand the structural characteristic of bridges can tell you what contribution those million rivets make into the overall structural integrity of the Golden Gate Bridge. They're all consistent, and so you can take that value times some number and get reasonable numbers out of it. In software, we may have hundreds or thousands of pieces too, but they're all uniquely handcrafted. We've never figured out a way to create really generic parts that can plug in, and so we have all these unique little things that we've created for specific problems. In the traditional engineering world, they have spent an enormous amount of effort on predictability. We want to be able to predict the characteristics of these physical things because it's so expensive to build those physical things to actually verify those characteristics. And in fact, in the 1950s and 60s, IBM invested an enormous amount of time and effort to try to come up with a calculus for software. They figured, hey, this is just an engineering discipline like civil engineering. We should be able to apply the exact same kind of rigor to that. And it turns out they're not nearly similar enough. But it turns out we don't need this predictability in software. And in fact, chasing it is not a good use of time. Because we have an advantage over traditional engineers. Our manufacturing process is free. It doesn't cost us anything to manufacture our code. So why don't we just manufacture it and test it in realistic kind of conditions to see if it's going to hold up under real world kind of conditions. And we can simulate things very easily in software because everything is soft. And so testing really is the engineering rigor in software. The same kind of rigor you get from statics and dynamics and mathematics and traditional engineering, we get on the opposite end, reactively with tests. So we don't have to be proactive. We can afford to be reactive because our manufacturing process is so cheap. Testing is the thing that lets us take this jumble of unique parts and isolate each part from the others and make sure that we understand its characteristics exactly before we incorporate it into all the other parts that are going to make up our piece of software. And so Jack Reeves concludes his essay by saying, software may be cheap to build, but it is incredibly expensive to design. Because every part of the software process is really part of the design process. The little preliminary sketches you make on napkins is part of the design process. Use cases and sequence diagrams are part of the design process. But they're not enough of the design process to say that's complete, because now you've got to get into the source code. So writing code is part of design. Debugging is part of design because changing bugs changes the source code, and that is your design document that you're creating. Every single thing in the software world is part of this design space, making it very, very expensive. Meaning that if you spend a lot of time up front trying to come up with a speculative design that doesn't really work under the real-world constraints that you find yourself in when you start building your piece of software, you've wasted a lot of very, very expensive, valuable time and getting no benefit from it. So I want to make a distinction here between architecture and design. You'll probably notice that the article series that I wrote for Developer Works is called Evolutionary Architecture and Emergent Design. And that's on purpose. In fact, Rebecca, who's doing a talk after me, is the one who convinced me that there's no such thing as emergent architecture. Let me dig into that just a little bit. This is a very abstract picture, but this actually tells an interesting story, the difference between architecture and design. There's a famous white paper that Martin Fowler wrote in, I think, 2006, which is still available on his website, called Who Needs an Architect? It's about the role of architects in agile projects. And in that paper, he gives several different extant definitions of software architecture. And he ends up giving my favorite definition of software architecture, the most accurate one I think I've ever seen, which is the architectural elements in software are the things that are hard to change later. And you can look at your software stack and ask things, are you hard to change later, and determine if it's architecture or design. So your database server is clearly architectural. So is your computer language. The web framework you're using is architectural because it's going to be hard to change that later. But the way you use that web framework, the way you use its workflow pieces, the way you use its validation pieces, those are part of design because those are relatively easy to change later. And this very abstract little blocks picture actually conveys a little bit of that sense and the reason why you can't have emergent architecture, because architecture is the foundation. You have to have some architecture to start with. You can't start with no architecture and build it up. So the trick here is, how can we start with architectural elements and have as few of those as possible and have more design elements which are relatively easy to change later? That's one of our goals, is to try to make more things design-like so we can change them more easily later. And that is, in fact, this distinction between evolutionary architecture, where you have to start with something, versus emergent design. You can afford to do a lot less in the design space because the problem will inform you and it's not so expensive to make changes. So let's talk about design, and in particular, emergent design. I'll give a definition here from Webster. Something that is emergent arises or emerges out of something that covers or conceals it and comes to light. That's one definition. Another definition is something that suddenly appears, arises unexpectedly, and calls for prompt action or urgency. The two definitions here very nicely correspond to the two key parts of emergent design that I'm going to dig into in this talk. And here's the first one. Let's say that at work you have a problem that's conceptually like this. It's this kind of tangled knot of concepts and connections between them. And you think about this while you're at work and you're working on this project. You think about it while you're driving home. You think about it while you're mowing your lawn. When your spouse is talking to you and you're supposed to be paying attention to them, you're still got a background thread thinking about this problem. It's just really bugging. You think there's got to be some sort of sanity there. And you think about it and concentrate on it until it finally resolves itself into some sort of reasonable structure that makes sense. That's really an exercise of finding abstractions and patterns that are already there in your code. Now, when I say the word patterns, that's kind of a loaded term in the software world. I'm not talking about patterns with a capital P here, like design patterns, the elements of reusable object-oriented software, which is a very useful concept, but it's very generic. What they did in the design patterns book is say, look, we've identified these things that show up in pretty much every piece of software we've seen pretty close, and we've created this big giant catalog for you to reference. Those are not the kind of patterns I'm talking about. I'm talking about patterns with a lowercase p. What I'm calling idiomatic patterns, patterns that are unique to your application or your suite of applications that nobody else in the world cares about. You'd never write a book about them because nobody cares. So a perfect example of this is you probably have a specific way within your company that you handle authorization, authentication for the parts of your applications. You probably do that consistently across your entire enterprise, or you desperately wish you did it consistently across your entire enterprise. That's an important thing for your business, is how do we handle this particular common use case? That's an idiomatic pattern for your business. Nobody outside your business cares that much because they have their own way of doing it, but it's very important to you. I further subdivide these idiomatic patterns into two subcategories, technical and domain idiomatic patterns. Technical patterns are things like validation or security or transactional data, any sort of reusable behavior that you would like to be able to reuse or harvest and reuse at some point in the future because it does something very elegantly or does it very simply or it's just the best way that you found to do it. And domain idiomatic patterns are things like business rules, shared functionality that you discover from a technical standpoint. It's not that uncommon in companies where, for example, marketing and sales are doing a lot of things that overlap and they don't really realize it, and the technical people realize that and find some common elements that they can harvest there. So when I use the term this way, patterns really describe effective abstractions, effective ways that we solve problems that we would like to leverage in the future anytime that problem or a very similar problem pops up again. And so that's one half of this idea of emergent design, is finding and harvesting idiomatic patterns. The second part of this has to do with this lean concept of the last responsible moment. And most of you are familiar with this. The idea of last responsible moment is how can you defer important decisions in a safe way? And of course, the concept here is that the longer you can delay the decision, the more knowledge and context you're going to gather about the real, true nature of the problem, not the problem you thought you were solving before you started working on it. Those things are never the same. You think about it, but once you actually get into the code and get elbow deep into it, things always change. And so the idea of last responsible moment is the longer you can wait, you have a better potential decision. But of course, the hazard here is waiting too long and actually causing yourself big problems. This is part of the magic of emergent design. The really tricky part is how do you determine exactly when that last responsible moment is? And I don't know, I don't have silver bullets. I'll give you some pointers of how we find this stuff, and I'll give you, toward the end, a case study for a project that I think pretty much nailed last responsible moment almost exactly. But that's still a tricky thing. The other thing I would mention about these two pieces of emergent design, finding and harvesting idiomatic patterns, really more pertains to existing brownfield code bases, whereas last responsible moment is very much a kind of greenfield concept. And both work in both cases, but they kind of lean in those directions. I'm going to talk about some things that make emergent design possible. Before I do that, I'm going to talk about something that is unfortunately way more common, which are things that make it hard. I'm going to talk about three very common things that we see in software projects that really hamper your ability to do something like emergent design. And the first one of these is the nature of complexity in software. Turns out software has two kinds of complexity. There is the essential complexity of a particular problem, and that is just the inherent complexity of whatever this problem is. Every problem has a certain amount of complexity that is just inherent to the problem itself. But unfortunately, we also have lots and lots of accidental complexity in the software world, which are all the externally imposed way that software becomes complex. It seems to me that this is where the true innovation happens in software, is figuring out new, unique ways to introduce accidental complexity on projects. It's amazing how much craziness is on projects a lot of times due to accidental complexity. Something that shouldn't be there, but it is because of historical reasons. And a lot of being able to do emergent design is being able to identify what is accidental versus what is essential. And I've got a couple of examples of this. This is, of course, on a spectrum. And a classic example of essential complexity comes from the original XP project. The original Extreme Programming Project, the C3 project, was a project to do a human resources system for auto manufacturers in the U.S. And these auto manufacturers have facilities in multiple cities, multiple states. They're scattered all over the country. And that was the goal, is to write an HR system. It turns out that one of the manufacturing facilities had a really clever union rep who managed to get the first day of hunting season off as a paid holiday for everyone just in that facility. That was really good for him because he managed to get something for his employees that nobody else had. But it made the software more complex because that's one of those little changes that ends up finding its way all over the place. Because now when you accrue work days and when you accrue vacation days and sick days and personal leave days, there's always this extra condition to see if it's this facility versus all the other ones. And the developers would have loved to go to the union rep and said, you know what, that sounds like a really good idea, but it's going to make our software too complicated, so I'm sorry, you can't have that. We don't have that luxury to do that, and so they had to figure out a way to solve this. This is the essential complexity of the problem. But as you start creeping a little further to the right, you end up with something that I've encountered a lot in projects, really fine-grained security on a page or a form somewhere. Somebody says, I want a control who can see and change every stinking field on this form or this page somewhere. And a software developer says, all right, we can do that. And so you build an enormous amount of infrastructure to handle that really fine-grained control. And you have to build some infrastructure so somebody can come in and define who can see and who can access every stinking field and every stinking form. And you finally roll this out to your users and let them see it. And they kind of turn their nose up at it. It's like, wow, that's really hard. I have to do that for every page? I don't want to have to do that. It surprises me that there's not more workplace rage in the software world, because you've poured all of your heart and soul into this elegant implementation and then your users are not that crazy about it. But this actually points to another problem in software, that very often users request things that they have fantasized about but they've never actually seen for real. And sometimes your fantasy life is richer than your real life. And when you see it in front of you, it's not nearly as cool as you thought it would be. A lot of times people ask for things without understanding the implications of what they're asking for, and when it gets delivered to them, that's way too complicated or way more cumbersome or not what they wanted after all. So that becomes a form of accidental complexity that's being driven by requests from people who don't understand the true nature of what they're asking for. And you keep creeping further to the right, and you end up with things like EJB and BizTalk. Which is not to say these are inherently flawed technologies, but the way a lot of people use them end up being flawed. Because these are heavily architectural elements. These are extraordinarily hard to change later. And so now you have this deadly question at the beginning of the project, are we going to need declarative distributed transactions at any point along the way? And if you say yes, it's like, okay, well, let's start with EJBs and build all that behavior in at the bedrock architectural level. but it adds so much ridiculous accidental complexity to your project. A lot of times the project fails before you even get to the first release because there's so much stuff to slog through before you even need that capability that you're taking on an enormous amount of accidental complexity. This distinction, of course, is not new at all. Fred Brooks made this distinction back in 1975 in the book Mythical Man Month, and we still haven't learned to fully evaluate this. The second thing that makes emergent design really hard is runaway technical debt. This is a metaphor that you're all very familiar with, I'm sure, from Ward Cunningham. It's this idea that there's a delta between if you could have the most perfect design, a code base where no amount of attention is too great to make it as perfectly honed as possible, versus all the compromises that you're forced to put in it because of external forces. The most classic driver of technical debt is schedule pressure. We've got to get this stuff done. But another driver of technical debt is the boat anchor anti-pattern that's on the C2 anti-patterns wiki, which is we've bought this expensive piece of equipment or this expensive framework, and you have to use it on every project, whether it makes sense to do that or not. Tying these two things together, I was at a client at one point, and I was helping them debug a problem they were having. They had this resume-driven development kind of project where they had EJBs, and they had a spring and hibernate being instantiated inside EJBs, and it was going to cocoon to produce XML and XSLT to produce a portlet that goes in this frame, and they were having problems. They were having stack blowing up on the application server. And at one point, somebody said, "Yeah, and our 7 users don't like it very much either." And I said, "This thing has 7 users?" And they said, "Yeah, well, it's eventually going to be like 10 users." And then I looked at what it does. You go in and fill out 3 forms and then click a button and it comes back with a billing code. That's the whole thing. And I said, "How much have you invested in this project so far?" $1.5 million. $1.1 million so far. Like, that's craziness. Why are you doing that? Well, the corporate mandate says everything goes through Cocoon, everything is EJB based, and so we're just following the corporate guidelines for what we're supposed to do. And so I went home and over the weekend rewrote it in Ruby on Rails. It took me about 2 hours. That made them change their mind that maybe we shouldn't standardize so much on this really complex architectural stack, particularly when we're building simple little things somewhere. Martin Fowler, our chief scientist, has actually created a quadrant of how you end up with technical debt. And he has these categories of reckless and prudent and deliberate and inadvertent. And so reckless and deliberate is, we don't have time for design, we've got to get busy. You guys start coding, I'll go upstairs and see what they want. Prudent and deliberate is, we have to ship now and deal with the consequences later. Inadvertent and reckless is, what's layering? This is talking to developers who say, you know, it's really convenient to put all your code in one giant JSP so you can scroll up and down and see where all the global variables are defined. And inadvertent and prudent is, now we know how we should have done it. Hindsight is always 20/20 in the software world. And in fact, Fred Brooks has an interesting observation about this. He said, if you want an awesome piece of software, write it once and then throw all that away and then write it a second time. And the second one will be awesome. Why is that? It's because for the second time through, there are no more unknown unknowns. You've already solved all the unknown unknowns. They're all known knowns now. And in fact, the second time you write it, you can probably estimate it to the day of when it's going to be done. Because it's easy. You've already done it once. Unfortunately, that's a really expensive way to write big software, is to write the entire thing and throw it away, but it is a way to get really good software. Technical debt is a reality in our world, and I don't think we should try to stamp it out, because it's not inherently a bad thing. Just like credit card debt is not inherently a bad thing. But you have to know how to use it. So the real trick on technical debt is not eliminating it, it's negotiating repayment for it. You first got to convince someone technical debt exists before you can start a conversation about repayment. Wouldn't you love to live in this world where your project manager comes to you and says, "We need these 3 new features," and you say, "Nope, I'm sorry, you've reached your credit limit on technical debt. We're not going to implement any more features, and you pay back some of this debt, and if you keep abusing this privilege, we're eventually going to declare technical debt bankruptcy on you and never listen to you again. It would be awesome to live in that world, but we don't live in that world. But that's the real problem, is that companies accrue technical debt and they never really go back and try to address it, and it has long-term bad implications. But how do you convince some manager type of this? Well, here's one of my favorite mantras in the agile engineering world: demonstration trumps discussion. You can talk about this stuff until you're blue in the face. You'll never convince someone until you can show them objective data about it. So I want to show you a couple of ways. There are actually myriad ways to do this, but I want to show you a couple of ways to illustrate technical debt to non-technical type people. Before I do that, though, I need to take a very short digression and talk about a metric. A very old metric, as it turns out, cyclomatic complexity, which measures the complexity of a method or function, giving it a numerical value. This is created by Tom McCabe back in the C days, so this is back in the early 70s. Here's the formula: edges minus nodes plus 2, where edges are possible paths through the code, and nodes are the actual lines of code. So if you look at a little method like this, you can draw it out in this kind of nodes and lines view, and the cyclomatic complexity of this is 4 minus 4 plus 2, so this has a value of 2. But it's kind of boring when the numbers cancel each other out, so here's a slightly more sophisticated method, and I've drawn it out in this kind of nodes and edges view, and I can number them. 8 minus 7 plus 2 gives me a cyclomatic complexity of 3, so this is one more complex than the one I showed you before. This now gives you a tool where you can compare two methods side by side and say, which one is the more complex method? This is useful in several ways. One, this allows you to run a metrics tool and go find the most complex class in your code base. That's not to say it is the most accidentally complex, but it is the most complex because you can find all the really complex methods in it. You can also, because this is a method-level metric or function-level metric, you can say, let's take the entire code base and run cyclomatic complexity over the entire thing and then divide it by the number of lines of code. That gives us cyclomatic complexity per method, which is what this graph shows. This is a graph from a real software project. This is a project that was from a public-facing media site in the UK. This is a snapshot in time. It's probably hard to see these numbers. From April 1st, 2006, to August 18th, 2007. This is cyclomatic complexity per line of code. That's the graph line that you see there. And the little gray numbers at the bottom are the public releases, or the releases of this software. Not the public releases, but the releases of this software. Just by looking at this chart, can you tell what the first actual public release of this software was? It turns out it's number 3. Because you can see technical debt manifesting right there. Because they're at the beginning of a project. This is a project for a client, and so the client is very, very nervous about getting to their ship date because they're not making any money. They don't start making money until this ships. And so what that's driving is complexity, which they then kind of tamp down, and then complexity, and there's a lot of volatility here in complexity per method. You can almost see the business analyst standing behind the developers going, is it done yet? What about now? What about now? What about now? Is it done yet? What about now? What about now? We got to get this thing out or we're going to lose all our money. And so they finally hit their date at release 3. And Eric Dernenberg, tech lead on this project, produced this much of the graph up to 3 and took it to the tech lead and said, okay, we need to do something about this because the trends are disturbing. Because we keep letting this climb, it's going to be bad. But in what way is it going to be bad? Technical debt manifests as a drag on velocity. Because the more technical debt you have, it's literally the more stuff in there that's a workaround for something that shouldn't be there. It's kind of like underbrush. If you're trying to walk through a field and there's really tall weeds, it really makes it hard for you to navigate and find the path that you're trying to be on. Technical debt manifests as slowing velocity. And in fact, some of you may have experienced this at some point where 2 years ago, adding a new feature to your code base could be done in a couple of days. Now it takes a couple of weeks to add the same level new feature because you've got this giant pile of technical debt laying around, causing it to be hard to do things like refactoring and changes to your code base. So Eric won his argument, and they said, okay, let's put some effort in. And so 3.0 and 3.1 was them going in and primarily cleaning up technical debt. And the inertia from that effort carried all the way down to this little valley right here at release number 7. Then an interesting thing happened. The client decided, we want more features faster. And so what they did was add a second parallel development team working on a new set of features, and that's where we started leapfrogging releases here. What you're seeing now is the gradual creeping complexity of having to integrate two code bases together. So it is creeping up in a much more controlled way now. But notice the other thing that this gives you. Cyclomatic complexity per line of code has a particular dollar value for a company. This is how much it's costing us to write software per developer. And you can look at the amount of software versus the effort here, and the amount of software versus the effort here, and make an objective decision, is it worth having this second team here? Because what are we trading off here? We're saying that we're going to get a higher overall velocity, but we're going to take a hit on individual velocity just a little bit. Because that's what this says, is you're going to be a little less productive because there's a little more complexity there than there was before. So every developer is going to get a little slower, but we got a lot more developers, and so that's going to speed us up. Now you can actually do a real evaluation. Is it worth monetarily having a second team, or are we better off reducing it back to the original team and lowering our complexity? I think this is a great example of demonstration trumping discussion. The way that Eric produced this was by hand. He actually wrote a little script that went to the first version, check it out, get cyclomatic complexity, go to the second version, check it out, automated all that, mashed all that into a single comma-separated file, and then pulled that into Excel and had it graph it for him. Eric actually does a lot of work on visualizations. This is a good example of one of his works. And there's a little bit of effort to create this. Fortunately, someone has already created a lot of these things for you. Now, most of my talk is kind of Java-centric because I had to pick a language, but a lot of these tools exist in other spaces. Sonar is a Java-specific tool, but what Sonar is an open-source tool that gives you a lot of nice visualizations for a bunch of common metrics like cyclomatic complexity, coupling. They give you a sample instance where they've taken a bunch of open-source pieces of software and run them through Sonar. And the nice thing about Sonar is it gives you a lot of results from very little effort. You basically install it and point it to your code base. And the main reason I talk about it here is one of the interesting things that Sonar has is a technical debt calculator that'll actually take some of the criteria in your project and calculate what it thinks your technical debt is on that project. Fortunately, you can tweak these formulas a little bit because one of the hazards in Sonar is that that number tends to come out a little bit high on the high side. So the last thing I want you to do is take this back to your code base, run Sonar against your code base, and it come back and say it's going to take $1.5 million to get your code base back to the point where it doesn't suck. And you're going to take that to some manager somewhere and show them that, and then you're going to jump out a window because there's no way they can afford $1.5 million to make your code not suck anymore. So you may want to tweak that formula a little bit. You want to frighten them, but not enough to jump out a window. So that's a really fine line there. You want to get their attention, but you don't want to frighten them to death. So it may take a little tweaking there to do that. This is really good if you have managers that can understand numbers and can read words. But if your manager doesn't have time to read words, then it comes with pretty pictures too. And in fact, this is really valuable in metrics because very often in metrics, in software metrics, raw numbers don't matter that much, but trends are everything. Cyclomatic complexity is a great example of that. I have a method that has a cyclomatic complexity of 12. Is that good or bad? I don't know. It depends on what it does. But if it's 12 now, and then I check it again in a month, and it's 20, and I check it a month later, and it's 35, clearly it's going in the wrong direction in terms of complexity, and so I can try to tamp that down some. This is the kind of thing that you don't want to see on a project. This is what they call time machine, which is the blue line is coverage, the green line is cyclomatic complexity, and the orange line is complexity per method. This is on the Struts code base. What this shows is that in September 2009, something horrible happened to the Struts code base. They imported a whole bunch of other stuff from another framework that had terrible test ratios and giant complexity, and it tanked their whole code base for a while. And you could see it on this graph. This is really valuable for you as a company. Let's say that your company merges with some company that has really awful, dysfunctional IT, and then a year later somebody says, why is our IT in such a mess? You can go, ooh, I have the answer to that question. Look, I've got a graph that shows that the day we merged, things went bad. Yes? So his question is, your manager's going to say, well, your code works, so why do you care? And you don't if you're never going to make a change to that code ever again. So when your manager says, it's fine, it works, say, okay, good, I never have to touch it again. Awesome, I can move to a greenfield project and my life will be much better. It's only when you have to change it that this manifests. And the more you change it, the more technical depth is there, the slower it's going to be and the longer it's going to take and the more complex it's going to be to do even simple things. So if it is, in fact, end of life. Now, when is end of life of code? Code ends life when you unplug the final server that has version control of that code and use a magnet to wipe the hard drive. That's when software is done, because nobody will ever make a change to it after that. Until you do that, somebody's always going to want to make a change to that software. The COBOL that prints paychecks, I guarantee you back in the 1960s when they wrote it, they thought that'll never be running in the year 2000. Guess what? COBOL still prints your paycheck. This is actually a much better picture. This is a spring batch, which shows over time gradually escalating complexity as they add more behavior, but very consistent complexity per method and very consistent code coverage throughout. So this works good if you have managers that only like pretty pictures. If your manager is so ADD you can't even get them to look at pretty pictures, you can show them pretty moving pictures. Yes?
Why is the complexity going up when the coverage is consistent?
Because it's doing more things. This is not accidental complexity. This is essential complexity. This code needs to do more things over time, and so it becomes more complex. It's not. That's an important point. Notice that complexity comes in two flavors. This is essential complexity. As it adds more actual behavior, you will see essential complexity go up.
Complexity per method is steady, whereas the number of methods are growing.
That's right. Correct. So if you have someone who doesn't even want to look at graphs, Sonar also has gapminder-inspired motion charts. And here's an example of one of those. This is complexity over complexity per method in struts. And you can see, as my little ticker gets to September 2009, the little bouncing ball is going to sprint to the upper right-hand corner and turn beet red. That's a good indicator that something has gone wrong in your code base at that time. That is the value, the numeric value over time. This is a gapminder style. So what you're seeing is time, is that little red ball, and that's the value of complexity over complexity per method. So Sonar's got a ton of nice things like this, and there are tools for other languages that give you some of the same kind of metrics. There's Independ in the .NET space that gives you some of these same kind of metrics. These metrics exist across a lot of different languages. And that's the second thing that makes emergent design really hard is a lot of technical debt. I like that underbrush kind of metaphor, because if you're trying to make your way through a jungle, if there's thick underbrush, it's hard to see the real path that you're trying to follow, and it makes it very easy for you to stumble off on a side path that's not leading you in any interesting place. So the third thing that makes emergent design really hard is rampant genericness. This is generally viewed as purely a good thing in the software world, that if we design our build lots of layers for extension, we can easily build more into it later. Which is true, but you end up adding complexity before it has to be there. This is what the pragmatic programmers called software entropy, the measure of complexity in software. And anything you have in your code base that's there for some future ability really manifests as technical debt and accidental complexity, because you're not using it yet, it's just in your way. And in fact, a lot of experience shows us that things you add to your code base because you just know it's going to need to be there, by the time you get 6 months to that place, it either doesn't need to be there, it's so different, you end up having to make a major change to it, and you haven't actually saved any time, and you just kind of generically obfuscated your code. So this is my perspective on technical debt. That when you add something to your project, that's when you start paying for it, And you only get payback when you start using that feature. And everything in between there is technical debt. This also applies, by the way, to big giant frameworks. If you've got a big giant framework of some kind and you're not using two-thirds of it, that's manifesting as technical debt because it's stuff in your way in the place of things that you should be paying attention to. Okay, well, I've been ranting about things that make it hard. Let's talk about some things that make it easier. Let's talk about some emergent design accelerators. The first of these I want to talk about is doing TDD as a design tool. What I call test-driven design. I think that when done correctly, TDD is as much or more about design than it is about having unit tests. I view TDD as a design aid that has a really cool side effect of leaving you with a bunch of tests. Because design will emerge from the test if you get out of their way. And you can get less accidental complexity because you're getting a better atomic understanding of intent. But I want to demonstrate this. So I'm going to show you an example of this concept. I've actually written about this on that article series. There's a two-parter about this example if you want to see more details about it. But I'm going to show you the results from it. So what I want to do is take a very simple problem and implement it two ways. I'm going to implement it test after, and I want to implement it test driven, and then compare the results. And here's the problem I'm going to solve. Finding perfect numbers. This turns out was numerology trivia back in the 15 and 1600s. A perfect number is where you take the sum of the numbers, not including the number, and it equals the number itself. 6 is a perfect number because its factors are 1, 2, and 3, and if you add 1 plus 2 plus 3, it equals 6. 28 is also a perfect number. If you take the factors, sum them all up, not including 28 itself, it'll equal 28. There are not that many perfect numbers in the universe, so that's what my code's going to do, is try to find perfect numbers. And the first version I'm going to write is a test after version. And so here's the code. So I have an isPerfect method that creates a list of factors. I add one of the number because those are always factors of a number. And now from 2 up to the number, if number mod I equals 0, that means I goes into number with 0 remainder, then this is a factor because it goes into that number evenly. I'll harvest that factor, then I'll sum them all up, and then I'll apply my formula to see if it's perfect or not. The sum minus the number equals the number. And I write unit tests for this, and it works. But it's really slow. And so I look for opportunities to speed it up some. Turns out there's a really good opportunity to speed it up. Right around there. Because there's an observation you can make about this problem domain, that factors always come in pairs. So let's say my target number is 16. When I grab factor 2, I can also grab factor 8 because 2 times 8 is 16, which means I don't have to actually traverse all the way up the list of numbers. I would be much more efficient if I just went halfway up the list of numbers. But I can be even more efficient than that if I only go up to the square root. Because that, by definition, is the number times itself, which equals my target number. So if I go up to the square root and harvest them in pairs, then I get all of them, and it's much more efficient. And so I change my code to do that. I now go up to the square root of the number, and I add both of them symmetrically right here, but it fails a unit test. Turns out there's an edge case around whole number square roots. Think about if my target number was 16. When I add 4, I'm going to inadvertently add 4 again. Well, that's easy enough to fix. So I'll come in and add a guard condition for that edge case. If it's not a whole number square root, then I'll add the symmetrical factor. This works okay, and it's acceptably fast, so I'm going to call it done. Now, the TDD version, I'm not going to show you each method. You've already seen the algorithm, and this has a lot more methods in it. This is very characteristic of a TDD code base. Lots of very small methods, just one thing each. And that's actually true in this code base as well. It is a very, very highly factored code base. And in fact, TDD code bases tend to have a particular shape. They're kind of pyramid shaped, where you have a lot of functionality written as very small methods, and then they aggregate together to build real functionality. In fact, I will maintain that if you show me cyclomatic complexity per line of code, I'll tell you if you have a TDD code base or not. Because in my experience, TDD code bases You average 1.5 to 2 per method, and in non-TDD code bases, it's between 10 and 15 for your methods. Yes. Cyclomatic complexity per line of code for TDD projects is usually between 1.5 and 2 per method. On non-TDD projects, it's usually 10 or higher. A lot of projects actually say any cyclomatic complexity under 10 is okay on this project. I think that's ludicrously high for a method. I want to see in the 1 to 2 range. And most TDD code bases naturally kind of fall into that because you're building very small methods. That's what cyclomatic complexity per method is measuring, is very small singular methods. That's exactly what TDD encourages. But an interesting thing happened along the way of building this TDD version. I realized something. Are the factors of a number a list of numbers? Does the order matter? Turns out it doesn't. What I'm really after here is a set of numbers. And a failing test showed me that. Because it said I was expecting 1, 2, 3, 6, and I got 1, 6, 2, and 3. Maybe realize, oh, dummy, these don't have to be ordered. I can make these a set. And so very early on in that code base, I converted everything to a set. But remember this code? Turns out this problem has nothing to do with whole number square roots. It has to do with the fact that I chose the wrong data structure up front. And this happens all the time. When I sat down to write this problem, I said, oh, factors are a list of numbers, and kept going, and then I had a breakage in a unit test. Now, in a perfect world, I would have gone back to every bedrock assumption I've made to the beginning of time to see where the problem was. But you never do that, especially when you can see a quick Band-Aid fix like this. And so what happened was, by choosing the wrong data structure, I inadvertently made my code more complex than it should have been, and the way that I fixed that complexity was to add more complexity to the code. Very often, the solution to accidental complexity is more accidental complexity because you don't really understand what the root problem was. This is where TDD is incredibly valuable for design, because it forces you to vet every little piece before you put it into the large overall structure that you're dealing with. The other really nice characteristic of TDD is that you spend very little time debugging traditionally. Because what is debugging? Debugging is building this big structure and then basically walking through it with a flashlight trying to find bugs. And if you're walking through this huge structure, it's going to take you time. When you're doing TDD, you never walk through big structures, or rarely, because you're debugging at the brick level, not the building level. And you get the little bricks debugged, and you have fewer bugs when you incorporate them into the overall building. So, testing is one of the ways to enable emergent design. And this is very much a kind of a greenfield way of handling emergent design. But let's talk about a brownfield example and refactoring toward design. So this is a little method that comes out of a little toy e-commerce site. What it does is not important. That it's hideously complex is what's important. What this does is take things from a shopping cart and put them into an order with line items, with a database using a low-level JDBC in the Java world. And I don't really care about the details of what it does. The point here is that I would love to be able to see if there's some useful idiomatic patterns hiding in this code, but I can't tell because it's just a jumbled mess right now. This code seriously violates what Kent Beck calls the single level of abstraction principle, in that you're jumping abstraction levels all over the place here. There's some really low-level JDBC stuff. There's some really high-level business method kind of stuff. They're all kind of jumbled together. So what I want to do is refactor this, and the first pass I'm going to do is just take the kind of common method, the common elements, and kind of just slurp them up and extract method. I've got a question for you. How many of you, when you're writing a method, put blank lines inside your method as kind of a spacer to separate things? It's okay. Everybody does it. You know what that blank line is? It's a cry for help. Make me my own method. Because you separated it out. You put a blank line there to say, this is conceptually with all this other stuff. Why don't you just make it a method so you can give it a proper name and test it? Blank lines is a smell. In methods, that means this should be another method. And I took the blank lines out of here just to make it fit. So that's exactly what I'm doing is basic, and this is easy in your code base. All you have to do is search and replace for blank line, just grab everything between blank lines, extract method. But if you do that, you'll end up with something like this. Because your refactoring tool has a very specific contract with you. I guarantee your code will still work the exact same way when I'm done. And when you have local variables defined like this, and you need to call out to other methods, the only thing your refactoring tool can do is pass them as parameters. And so you end up this parameter explosion when you do this style of refactoring. But I'm a human. I understand the implications of moving things up to the class rather than as local variables, and I know that it's safe in this case to do that. So I'm going to make another refactoring run that's partially tool-based and partially manual and get this code to here. And now I'm getting somewhere because now I can tell what this code does. It does some setup, it adds a couple of things, it completes a transaction, something goes wrong, it rolls it back, and finally it cleans stuff up. Yes? I can barely hear you, so speak up, please. Java is really good at method invocation and class loading. So you should never worry about the cost of method calls versus the readability of your code.
Is it just Java or any language is kind of...
Pretty much any language now, I mean, you shouldn't worry about that. This is, so if you're really worried about that, you should write everything in hand-tuned assembly language. There's no way it'll ever be faster. It'll take you 20 years to write a web application, but it'll be the fastest web application you've ever seen. But 20 years from now, probably not going to give you much business value in the intervening 19 years. So there's a trade-off there. You shouldn't worry about this. Worry much more about the structure of your code than any sort of performance problems. If you do find a performance problem, go back and fix it then. Don't prematurely optimize it and end up creating a lot of technical debt just for that infrastructure.
Thank you.
So now I've actually got something, because if I kind of replace those two specific lines of code, I have created kind of a template here that I can harvest and reuse for transactional data access. Yes? So methods do add complexity, but they're essential complexity. They're not accidental complexity, unless you are just creating one method per line of code. There are huge benefits to having well-factored methods that are cohesive and just do one thing. So that's something worth pursuing. Even if it adds a little bit of essential complexity to your code base, it's paying off in that it's isolating changes so you can go find them.
So is it safe to assume that you need not bother about class-level complexity? You are well off if you are just taking care of your method-level complexity.
Well, no, his question is, do you just care about method level versus class level? You care about complexity overall. So this actually does not have the damaging effect that you think it does on your code base, because every method has at least one psychometric complexity because it does at least one thing. This really does not cause, because you're not going to create a method per line of code. So the amount that it increases your code base well pays off by the factoring of your code base into nice cohesive methods to get things done. Yes?
Methods are used by this method itself. So those will be private,
most probably. Yes, those will probably be private methods.
Difficult to test those methods individually?
So the question is, wouldn't it be difficult to test those methods? No, it's not at all difficult to test private methods. You can use reflection to test them. If you're using Groovy, you can actually just call them directly, because Groovy, when you unit test Java code, ignores private, because private's annoying if you're trying to do testing. Or you can make them public and then make sure by convention that no one calls them.
So these methods also should be tested, the private methods,
yes.
Whatever we are breaking to.
I agree. I believe that private methods should be tested. In fact, people who say that you should never test private methods, you should only test the public methods that call them, are not doing TDD by definition. How did those private methods come into being if you didn't test first? By definition, if they say you should never test private methods, you're not doing proper TDD unless you're writing that method and then refactoring them out into private methods. But then even then, you're not really doing TDD. You're building big methods and then refactoring them back out. So I want to show you, I'll actually come and harvest this as an idiomatic pattern, but I want to show you another refactoring example first. So what I wanted to do is take an existing code base out in the world, an open source code base, and see if I can use some metrics to go find some idiomatic patterns that haven't been discovered before. So I'm going to do that. First, though, I need one more metric. We have cyclomatic complexity. Now I want afferent coupling. Afferent coupling is a metric that tells you how many other classes reference you as a class. And so if you have a class like this, and you have six other classes that reference it, the afferent coupling for this class is six. So six other things reference this class. And so in some ways, afferent coupling is a measure of importance. Because if a lot of classes use this, it's probably pretty important. And cyclomatic complexity is a measure of complexity. So using these two in conjunction, you could go find the most complex, important classes in your code base. So that's exactly what I'm going to do. So I said I wanted to, so here's the criteria I wanted for the code base that I was going to do this for. I wanted to be open source so that you could do this as well. I wanted to be around for a long time so that you'd hope that most of the design elements, the important design elements, have been chased out of it. I wanted to be ubiquitous. And I wanted to be in Java, since most of this talk is in Java. So I chose Struts. Struts is a very well-known web framework in Java. Thousands, probably tens of thousands of web applications have been written in this thing. It's well over 10 years old. It's in its second major release. You would hope that by now the major design issues have been chased out of Struts. Let's see. So I downloaded Struts, and I ran a tool on it called CKJM. This is a metrics tool for Java. It's a little freeware metrics tool. It runs the Chittimer and Kimmerer object-oriented metric suite on Java, which is a whole bunch of metrics. The two metrics that I want, afferent coupling and complexity, come out of CKJM, and so that's why I used it for this problem. Yes? Open source, freeware, yes. Very, very small tool. It actually does the entire Chittimer and Kimmerer object-oriented metric suite against Java code, so that includes both couplings, cyclomatic complexity, and a whole bunch of other metrics that I didn't include here. There's an object-oriented suite called Chittimer and Kimmerer that defines, I think, six different metrics for object-oriented code, and it runs all of them against Java code. This tool is specific to Java. You can get cyclomatic complexity for every language on Earth that's structured. There's Ruby, PHP, JavaScript. You can't get it for SQL because it's not a structured language. In fact, most code coverage tools give you cyclomatic complexity for free as part of the code coverage tool. And afferent coupling you can also get for every code base in the world. Independ gives it to you for .NET. It's a very easily harvestable metric. And the way that CKJM reports cyclomatic complexity, now remember cyclomatic complexity is a method level metric, but CKJM reports things at the class level because it's an object-oriented metric suite. And so what it does is take the sum of the cyclomatic complexity of all the methods. So that's the number that it reports here. The WMC means weighted method complexity. If I look at the Struts code base, it turns out the most complicated thing in all of Struts is this class called double list UI bean. It has a cyclomatic complexity of 66, which is hideous. And so if I wanted to go tackle the most complicated class in Struts, this is the one I'd go for. But then look across to the afferent coupling. This guy's only used by three other classes. So if I go to enormous effort and make this better, it only directly benefits three other classes. It may indirectly benefit others, but there's only a direct correlation here. What if I sort these by afferent coupling instead? The most important thing in the Struts universe is component, which is not surprising, but I'm not looking for the most important thing. I'm looking for high combinations of numbers. I want to find important, complicated things to see if they are overly complicated. And the one that catches my eye here is the one five down UI bean, which has a complexity of 53, and it's used by 22 other classes. So I started poking around in that class to see what's making it so complicated. And here it is. This is a method called evaluate params. My favorite part by far of this method, I don't know if you can see this, the very last line of this method is evaluate extra params. So it's almost like the developer just got tired of typing. It's like, oh God, I can't type anymore. Evaluate extra params. Okay, I'm done. This is hideously complex. And it turns out that if you start poking around in Struts at a lot of complicated, important classes, they have evaluate params or evaluate extra params in it. So I got curious. I did a little command line judo. It said, give me all the Java source files and struts, and then within those, show me which ones have a method declaration for evaluate something params. There they are. I have found an idiomatic pattern in struts. And this, I think, is a great example of this because 15 years ago when they started working on struts, there's no way that somebody said, you know what, in 15 years, the most complicated part of the code base is how we handle URI parameters. That's such a simple thing. It's so simple, in fact, that they've done it over and over and over and over and over again. I wrote this up as part of that article series that I was talking about. And one of the struts committers contacted me after the fact and said that he had independently just recently discovered the exact same thing and he was undertaking fixing it by extracting that as an embedded framework. So if you download struts now, there's a parameter handling embedded framework, and by doing that, he reduced hundreds of lines of code and tens of cycle complexity points out of the struts code base, made the entire thing smaller and less complex, and preserve the functionality by taking all that scattered code and consolidating it. Nobody had gone and found that scattered code before we applied these tools to it. So that's a good example of using just a few metrics tools to actually learn some things about your code base that are actionable that you can do something about. So I've been talking about finding these things. What do you do after you've found them? How do you harvest these things and make use of them? There are a couple of different ways to do this. The most obvious way to do this is just harvest it as an API. And that's exactly what I'm going to do here with my idiomatic unit of work pattern that I created before. Remember, this is the target of my refactoring code. And if I take out those two specific lines of code, this becomes a kind of generic transactional data access thing. And so here's where I can use proper gang of four design patterns. This is really just the command design pattern, and so I can go and harvest that by creating a wrap-in transaction method, and now my add order from method is this code at the bottom. It's worth pointing out here that, remember the first version of this method that I showed you that took up the entire slide in 9-point font? This is the final version of that method. Where all the reusable code has been boiled out of it and harvested somewhere else, this is what it really ends up being, which is wrap this command in a transaction and do those two pieces of work. But actually, going back to what Venkat was saying earlier this morning, Java forces a lot of ceremony and noise on you. What I really want to do is say these two things wrapped in a transaction, but I have to create this anonymous inner class with this execute method and all that other stuff. What if I wrote this in a more modern syntax language, like Groovy? Here's that same code, but in Groovy, anything between curly braces is a code block. And you can pass a code block as a parameter, and you can execute it just by putting an open-close paren after the variable name. Because Groovy has code blocks, lambdas, closures, you actually can get rid of the command design pattern entirely. The command design pattern is a band-aid for a language that doesn't have higher order functions. If you have higher order functions, you can boil away the command design pattern forever, and it sinks to just this, where I'm passing functionality up to someone who has the context to execute it. So this is a good example of, in a more expressive language, a lot of the boilerplate kind of melts away. I'll come back to this concept in just a second. The other way to harvest these idiomatic patterns is with annotations. These are annotations, attributes in C#. You can't harvest everything this way, but one of the things that you want, a characteristic you'd really like out of the patterns that you harvest, is that they stand out from the code around it. Anything that you've found that you've harvested as an idiomatic pattern is very valuable for your company. You'd like for it to stand out. And a great way to make things stand out is to use annotations for them because they look different from the code around them. So for example, let's say for bizarre historical reasons, my country class, the name of the country has to be 10 or less. I can create an annotation in Java that lets me decorate the domain class and say, make sure this thing is never greater than 10 in length. I can create a little validator framework that basically takes a class, walks through each method, looks for a particular annotation, and if it's present, calls the validate method on it. And both of these at the bottom are abstract. So I supply the annotation type and the method, and I can validate things. And so if I want my max length validator, I extend my validator. There's my validate method that makes sure that it's not no more than 10 characters. If it is, it throws an exception. Annotations can be pretty sophisticated. Here is one that says make sure that if you add a new country to this region, that it's not already there. So make sure that it's unique. I can use that same little validator framework to do that. The point of this is that annotations can actually get to the runtime values of collections and things like that that are running in your code so that you can do verifications and other sorts of things that are pretty sophisticated. And here are some tests that show that these annotations work. The reason that annotations are so nice for this is that annotations add orthogonal expressiveness to your language. They don't look like other code, which makes them stand out, which is exactly what you want for the really valuable pieces of code you've written. You want them to stand out and look a little unusual. So developers consume a lot of annotations that framework writers create. I don't think we create enough of them ourselves, because when it's applicable, this is a really nice way to be able to harvest behavior. But I can't resist showing you this. Sticky annotations in Ruby, and of course this works in JRuby as well. So consider this little problem. Here's a unit test for some code in Ruby. And let's say that this complex calculation thing takes a really, really long time. So long, in fact, I don't want to take the time hit for running that when I'm doing unit tests. I only want to run that test when I'm doing acceptance tests. Now, Ruby being a very flexible syntactic language will let you conditionally define methods if you want. So I can come in here and say, if the environment variable build has acceptance as a value, then define that test method, and it'll execute if that's true. But that's kind of ugly, especially if you need to do this for several methods. That would kind of make your class look very unusual. And so a much easier, more elegant way to do this is to create an annotation for it. So this is only on acceptance will you run that. Here's the entire implementation of acceptance only. This takes advantage of a Ruby language feature called a hook method, where you can hook into a class. And here I'm defining a method called acceptance only, which sets a private member variable to true or false based on the status of this guy. And then I write a method added method. Method added in Ruby, every time the class adds a method, it executes this method for you right afterwards. And in here I say, unless acceptance build is true, then remove that method you just added. This is the computer science equivalent of the game whack-a-mole, you know, whack-a-mole, where the things pop up and you hit them again. So as soon as you declare this method, it strips it right back out if that annotation's not true. And then it resets acceptance build to false so that you have to put acceptance only on top of every method that you want to only run at acceptance, and that works beautifully. Here's another example of that. Let's say that you had some Ruby code that you wanted to log every single thing that happens within this method. You can use hook methods for this as well. So I'll come in and create a logged. And now in method added, what I'm going to do is save the name of the old method and then redefine this method, do all my logging stuff, and at the very end, I'm going to turn around and call the original method I saved. Does anybody know what this is called in Java? What I just did? Aspect-oriented programming. This is an after point cut. After you do this work, then do my code. Right, this is actually a before point cut, because I'm doing stuff before I call my code. You know what they call this in the Ruby community? Monkey patching. It is the exact same mechanism. There's just a little bit of difference in terminology. It's called monkey patching because somebody originally called it gorilla patching, like guerrilla warfare, but somebody misheard it as gorilla, like a primate, and so they thought it would be funny to call it monkey patching. All monkey patching is aspect-oriented programming in the Ruby world, but the language already supports it. You don't have to bolt on another framework with a post-compiler or bytecode weaver or any of that stuff you have to do in Java. The complexity to make this happen in Ruby is significantly less than Java because the language supports it at the metaprogramming level. You don't have to bolt something on the other side. This is an old example, but a classic one. There are struts harvesting something off a form, and there it is in Ruby on Rails. Expressiveness matters. It matters a lot more than most people give it credit for, because I agree with Jack Reeves. I believe that code is your design, and you want the most expressive medium you can find. This is like painting with crayons versus watercolors versus oil paints. It's harder to paint with oil paints, but you can get much more sophisticated results with oil paints than you can get with crayons. It's really important to understand where to apply power and when to use it, but you need the power there. Frequently in software, that becomes metaprogramming and meta-language nature. So you should push for expressiveness as hard as you can. Now, I know most of you probably don't get to pick which language you write code in on a day-by-day basis. It's Java or it's .NET. But that doesn't mean you can't start taking advantage of this on the periphery. Most of the time, they will let you control your own developer tools. So a classic example of this, if you're writing Java code and you're writing unit tests in Java, you should stop right now. It is much easier to write unit tests for Java code using Groovy. Groovy is well designed to unit test Java code. It has mocking built in. It automatically ignores private, so you can TDD private methods in Groovy without having to fiddle with reflection and all that other junk in Java. And it's unit test. That code never goes into production. So why not use that? It's going to make your life a lot easier. It's going to make it easier for you to exercise, like Venkat said, because you remove the friction there from doing tests by using a more expressive medium. Build tools, another great example. I've come to believe that there should never be XML in a build tool, that Ant and Maven are irrevocably broken because they are too declarative. You need languages because you always need the flexibility of a language at the build level, which is why I love tools like Rake. Gradle is actually a fantastic thing. It is the get-out-of-jail-free card for Maven because it understands all your Maven stuff, but it is language-based rather than XML-based. It is much more expressive and much more powerful. Why not start using that? Even if you're writing Java production code, there are lots of places on the periphery you can start using more sophisticated tools and languages to make things go faster. This really comes down to abstraction styles. And we're all very familiar with imperative abstraction styles, which encompasses both structured and modular programming and object-oriented programming. But you hear a lot of people talk about functional programming now. That's a different abstraction. Solving problems in a functional programming language are going to be different than solving problems in an imperative programming language. And so most people think that to switch abstraction styles, you have to switch languages, but you don't. A great example of this is this concept of anti-objects. This came from a paper from Uppsala in 2006, I think it was, a paper called Collaborative Diffusion. And the point of this paper was that the metaphor of objects can go too far by making us try to create objects too much inspired by the real world. This is the problem: if all you have is a hammer, then every problem looks like a nail. If the only abstraction your language supports is object orientation, then you're going to try to cram every problem on earth into object orientation, even when it doesn't make sense to do so. That's actually why we have aspects, because it turns out there are classes of problems that you just can't cram into the object-oriented tree, and you need cross-cutting concerns to handle those things. The idea of anti-objects is to create something that does the opposite of what you think it should be doing if it gives you a simpler solution. It's kind of like this optical illusion. Is this a vase or is it two faces? It depends on your perspective. And so there's a fantastic example of this anti-object principle. It's around how the game Pac-Man works. Now, I have to warn you, I'm about to explain how Pac-Man works, and it's not going to be as enjoyable anymore. So if you want to play Pac-Man and keep enjoying it, you should probably leave now. Sometimes knowledge comes at a cost, and there's going to be a cost to this, because I'm going to explain how it works, and it's not going to be nearly as cool when I'm done. So think about the original Pac-Man console machine, which came out in the early 1980s. It had less memory and processing power than some watches have now. And they had a really complicated problem to solve. How do you calculate the distance between two moving objects in a maze? They didn't have anywhere nearly enough processing power to do that. So they took an anti-object approach. Now, if you're a Java object-oriented programmer, probably your first instinct here would be to create a ghost class and create a Pac-Man class and create a fruit class and instantiate all those guys and calculate the distance between them. That's not what they did. They built all the intelligence into the maze itself. The maze is basically a state machine that executes rules for every cell in the maze. And they invented this concept of Pac-Man smell. When Pac-Man is sitting on a cell, it has maximum Pac-Man smell, and the cell he just vacated has maximum Pac-Man smell minus one, and it decays pretty quickly. And all the ghosts do is wander around semi-randomly looking for Pac-Man smell, and when they encounter it, they go to the next adjacent cell where the Pac-Man smell is stronger, and they can move slightly faster than Pac-Man, and that's the whole game. They played a really nasty trick on you because they gave the ghost eyes. They can't actually see you. They can only smell you. So if they'd made it a nose, it would be actually a lot more clear-cut is what they're doing there. But notice the next time you play Pac-Man, you can run right up on a ghost because they can't see you coming. They can only tell where you've been. They only detect Pac-Man smell, and you only leave that when you've walked across part of the game board. That's the whole game. That's a great example of flipping the problem to the opposite of what you think you should be modeling and ending up with a much simpler solution. There's some other solutions in the collaborative diffusion paper. They were trying to model in software drops of water in a bucket, and they were trying to model the drops. It was really complex. And then they ended up modeling the water. And it was much simpler. We did this on a project where we were managing leased rail cars. And we were trying to build all this logic to get rail cars in the right parts of the rail yard, and we realized that's dumb. We should write the abstraction at the track level. That was an anti-object approach. That turned out to be way simpler worrying about the tracks than the actual cars that were running on the tracks. So this is a good example of abstractions and finding and harvesting idiomatic patterns in the brownfield world. But I want to come back to last responsible moment. As I said earlier, this is the tricky thing. And I can't tell you how to find this, but I can give you some clues. One of the things you can look for is that over time, a particular element of your piece of software, a particular component, a particular service, will have a particular job to do. And over time, it will take on more responsibilities sometimes. Every time there's an uptick in responsibility, whether that's more code or more scale or whatever it is, that's a good time to evaluate that component and ask it, has your last responsible moment arrived or not? So this is one of the tasks of an architect on an agile project, is have a pretty good idea of these components and where they are in terms of complexity and how much work should they be bearing, etc. Another great tool that most of you are already familiar with, I'm sure, which are spikes. Spikes are time-boxed experimental coding exercises so that you can learn something about your code base. A lot of times you end up misestimating things because you don't have enough understanding about the true problem. Spikes are a way to accelerate that, so you create a time box for 2 hours or 2 days. I think the longest spike I've ever been on is a week. But during that spike, we were trying to see, could an open source search engine replace the commercial search engine we have? So we had all these criteria we needed to try. So we spiked out one of each category, and by the end of the week, we had pretty good confidence that, yeah, we could replace the sophisticated functionality of this guy with the open source one, because we understood a lot more about it. So here's a case study of a project that I think did an extraordinarily good job with last responsible moment. This is for a site that ThoughtWorks has been working on close to 5 years now. This is OVE.com, onlinevehicleexchange.com. This is a site that allows car dealerships to buy and sell used cars at auction. This is a Ruby on Rails project that we've been working on in Atlanta, it turns out, for about 5 years. And the really interesting part of this is the evolution of asynchronous messaging within this application. Relatively early on, within the first 6 months of this application, the users decided they wanted status on uploads. So this is an auto auction site for car dealers. It's not unusual for people to upload 50 cars at a time, and each car has 50 or 60 photos. Because it turns out that you don't trust used car dealers. It turns out that other used car dealers don't trust used car dealers either. So when they sell each other cars, they basically want a photo of pretty much every molecule of the car to make sure that it's all exactly what they say it is. And so every one of these listings has lots and lots of photos. It takes a long time to upload this. Nobody wants to look at an Ajax spinner for an hour. And so we want a progress bar. We want the ability to start it and then come back and see if it's done. That's classic asynchronous behavior. And so one of the suggestions was, well, we should add a message queue, because that's the traditional way you handle asynchronous behavior. But then we did a couple of little spikes and found this little thing, background RB, this little thing in the Ruby world, that basically simulates a single message queue backed by a relational database. And we did a couple of spikes and said, you know what, that's good enough. But the tech lead on this project realized that at some point in the future, we may have to replace this. So he put it behind the Ruby equivalent of an interface. At about the one-year mark, second asynchronous requirement came in, timed things like cron jobs, things that automatically kick off at a certain time of day. We thought about asynchronous message queue, but then realized we could create another instance of background RB, and it would work just fine. So we left it. At about the two-year mark, another asynchronous requirement came in, things that are continually run, things like updating counts and cache values and things like that. This whole time, we'd been using a simple message queue backed by a database, but it was starting to creak a little bit under the amount of load that we were putting under it. Also, one of the DBAs on the project had discovered that we were using his precious relational database as a backing for a message queue, and he started making this face at us every time we saw him, which viewed as probably a bad thing. And so then we switched to a real message queue in the Ruby world called Starling. But what happened there? This goes back to what I was saying before, that you don't know what you don't know in projects. And a lot of times, there's this kind of knee-jerk reaction to say, oh, we need asynchrony, but we don't know all that we're going to need asynchrony for, so let's buy the fanciest message queue we can, and then we'll grow into it. But that's deadly. Because if you don't grow into every single one of those features, all you're doing is purchasing technical debt. There are going to be a lot of pieces of this thing that you don't need that are in your way. There's a bunch of configuration there. It instantiates a bunch of stuff that you're not using. It's not as efficient as it would be if it were single purpose. So what happens in a lot of cases is you end up paying money for technical debt that you never justify. When you overbuy tools early on, you're buying technical debt that a lot of times you'll never actually get payment back from. You're actually much better off trying to go as simple as you can and actually learn the nature of the problem. By the two-year mark, we knew pretty much exactly what we needed asynchrony for in this application, and we picked the simplest thing that did the work we needed to get done. We didn't have to get a really fancy bells and whistles kind of message queue because we understood the problem enough to say this is sufficient for what we need to get done. But notice what else we did there. Messaging infrastructure is traditionally architectural, hard to change later. But by isolating that behind a component, behind an interface, when it came time to change it out, it took one pair about a week to swap out background RB with Starling and didn't affect anybody else in the project. What we managed to do was convert it from an architectural element into a design element, something that's easy to change later versus something hard to change later. This is the benefit of doing well-factored component-based systems, is that if you can get it right, you actually convert architectural elements into design elements, making them much easier to change later without having to do major infrastructural factoring exercises. So to summarize, evolutionary architecture and emergent design require really good engineering practices. You really need TDD, you need the ability to do refactoring, you really need things like continuous delivery in a big way. And in fact, right after lunch, Rebecca Parsons, who's the CTO of ThoughtWorks, is doing a fantastic talk on evolutionary architecture and continuous delivery together that is exactly in this space. Very often, trying to predict the future leads to over-engineering. Over-engineering is a bad thing. And so this may sound like a subtle distinction, but this is what I prefer now, is to prefer pro and reactive to predictive. What I mean by that is try to be proactive for the pieces of your application. Look at things like asynchronous and say, okay, let's put that behind a component. That's being proactive about it. Being reactive is that every time it takes on new responsibilities, reevaluate it. Is it reached its last responsible moment? Is it now time to replace this with something more robust or more specific? Being pro and reactive works much better than trying to be predictive, because being proactive and then reactive means that you're paying attention to the real things on the surface versus just trying to guess what's going to happen in the future. So I'm very close, I'm essentially out of time, and lunch is being served, so I don't want to keep you here over lunch, but I will be happy to answer some questions if you'd like. Yes? So the question is, do processing XML, and you prefer to do it in Ruby, you said? Groovy, okay. So you can do it either way. I mean, 6.1 half does the other, as long as you're not doing crazy things about, you know, calling out, you know, shelling out to it or something like that. It's going to start new processing and things like that. You could go 6.1 half does the other in that case, I think. I don't see hard. Yes? I just barely hear you. Can you speak up? Yes. Yes, that is correct. There are two ways to do this. When you start a new project, doing testing and things like that, with existing projects by using metrics to harvest design elements out of code.
Yeah, but you see, there before Java appeared, everybody was enthusiastic, and the programming languages were proliferating, and nobody was concerned with software architecture. Out of the blue, they realized without software architecture, you couldn't move on, and then you move to software architectures, okay?
I'm not throwing out software architecture. We still have architecture here. We have evolutionary architecture.
No, no, I know, but in your presentation, you skipped the level. Rebecca is going to talk
yes.
later.
I'm only talking about design here.
No, I know, but the way you are talking, it's like we talk. We need to talk about anything, okay? And then you have a language, and you talk about everything. The idea would be that programming would be like this. You have a domain you need to implement, you have a code, a code, and things emerge, like when you talk, right?
Yes.
Okay, great.
Yep. Okay, yes.
As a part of this, refactoring away the technical debts. So, instead of say 5 classes, refactor to say 25 classes. Each class has a single responsibility.
Mm-hmm.
So, one of the concerns which I hear from fellow developers is it's very difficult to read that code compared to if I say have 5 classes. I have to jump multiple hoops to read and understand that code. So, like, how do we address that concern?
You got IDEs now that make the code browser in Smalltalk look anemic. So it's very easy when you have factored code like that. You know, in any IDE, you can hold down control and click on a method name, and it'll take you to that method. You can literally browse your code. In fact, I think that having big, giant, long methods is much harder to read and understand than have well-factored methods that have good names for them. It's much easier to understand a code base that has very small methods with explicit names than these methods that are 20 or 30 or 200 lines long. Nobody understands what a 200-line method does. Not even the person who wrote it, not the person who has to deal with it, because there's just too much there. So I think you're much better off having, I actually find it much easier to navigate code bases that have classes, well-factored classes with lots of very small methods in them, because it's easy to trace down functionality. Yes? If you're doing test-driven development, then you write the test before you write the code. That's test-driven development.
Yeah. So in that case, I mean, is it that we are facing the issues that what will be the implementation of the test cases? Because, I mean, in my actual code, if I take help of the some other classes method, I might need to mock that in my unit tests.
Mm-hmm.
But until and unless I implement that my actual code, business code, I don't know what are the methods I will be using or how many conditions, what will
be. Which is mocking for? mocking or stubbing. For the things that are not implemented yet, but you know you need, use mocking or stubbing for those.
Okay, so if we do in parallel, that's, I write some test cases in that, and then I implement the source code, actual source code, and then again in the write the test cases, is it against the TDD principles?
Well, if you write code before you write the test, you are by definition not doing test-driven development. You're doing test after development, which has value, but it has no design value like test-driven development does. Test-driven development forces you to think about every little method when you implement it so that you have fewer bugs at that level than you do in test after code. Testing is valuable whether you do it before or after. It's a much more valuable design aid if you do test-driven development because you're being forced to verify your assumptions about every method before it goes into the larger methods that are calling it. Yes?
Let's say our project is very time-bound, and so during that time, how would we prefer to be reactive to predictive?
I'm sorry, can you speak up? It's very hard.
Like we have a time-bound project, right? So how do we prefer to be reactive to predictive? We don't have time to choose and to be reactive to some tool, like your case study. You earlier used some other messaging queue system, and at the end you found Starling, right? So that time you didn't have time to look around that this is a right queue to use.
Mm-hmm.
So how to find that at the right time?
Finding the last responsible moment is really tricky. It takes a lot of experience. It takes understanding your domain and all the architecture. So that's why agile architects must be very hands-on and see and touch code all the time because they have to have a really good feel for what parts of the code base are perfectly good, what parts are maybe reaching toward their last responsible moment. But it's always worth time to do some research on something and not just blindly pick something because you're probably buying a lot of technical debt and it's going to be hard to get rid of that later, particularly if it's some sort of architectural element, because now it's going to be a huge refactoring effort to change that later versus changing it or doing some research up front.
So, Oman, I wear a dual hat, both as a tech manager as a developer, right? So I see last responsible moment, and I get it as a developer. Makes sense as when you want to actually go for the decision. But to plan things, to budget things as what tools I need for the team, right? You know, I see it's tricky, right? Is there a way around, like you said, you know, you need to be really expert in agile ways to be hands-on developer to make a decision at the last moment, right? But I also want to know, as a manager, to know what is the cost of the tool which my team is trying to bring in to do the project.
So you're talking about the cost of the tools to do this or the cost of time to do it?
The cost of the tools to start with, and obviously on the time, right?
So virtually, what space are you in? .NET, Java, Ruby, PHP, Python?
It's Python.
Python?
Yeah.
I don't know. I'm not in the Python space much. I know there's a lot of open source stuff in Python. I know all the metrics tools I talk about exist in Python. But I'm not in that space, so I can't make comments about tooling. In the Java world, the Java, Ruby, Clojure, Scala, Groovy, .NET world, there are open source tools to do all this stuff. So you don't need to pay a penny for it. But Python, I would guess, is the same. But I'm not in that space, so I don't know.
All right, thank you.
Independ, the letter N, depend. It's actually a commercial tool, but it does efferent-afferent coupling at the class and package level. It has some really nice visualizations for things. There's another tool that works for .NET that's free called Source Monitor that gives you some nice visualizations. It gives you cyclomatic complexity and some other stuff. It's freeware. Only runs on Windows, but it's a freeware tool. Yes. Mm-hmm. Is that microphone on? No, there's another one. There's a better one.
Yeah.
There you go.
But I have an opinion which I want to validate with you. Is
okay.
That whether it is design element or test driven, idea is that we are actually thinking ahead and then only coding, right? That's what, so that's the design part is fine.
You actually, when you start talking to the microphone, you got quieter, so speak up. I can hardly hear you.
Yeah, I think originally it was better. So is it okay now? All right. So what I was saying is that when we go with a test driven development approach, the idea is first we capture, whether in the form of design or test, actually we're capturing the requirements to which I need the functionality to be written about.
Mm-hmm.
But the opinion that I have and what I have practically seen is that mostly developers end up being writing the happy path really right, but they are not having the destructive mindset to write design elements or the test cases in such a way that which will destroy the system as well.
So what I would say there is that you're actually conflating two kinds of testing that we think about, unit testing and functional testing. So for us, unit testing is very much purely a developer tool, and it's all about design and structure of code. Functional testing is about what the code does. And so we actually, even if we use the exact same tools to write them, like JUnit, we separate those as separate things because functional tests are going to be much more coarse-grained. They're going to touch a lot of different pieces, you know, multiple classes, you know, talk to databases and stuff like that. So that's how we differentiate those, is unit tests. So what we typically use is a tool like Cucumber would be a good example of a BDD tool. Business analysts, developers sit down together and write the specifications in Cucumber. That then becomes the target for the developer. And so they take the failing Cucumber test, and now they use unit tests to implement little pieces of that. So they may get 14 unit tests to pass to get one green over in Cucumber. And so that becomes the business specification they're working against, whereas unit tests is just about structure and design.
Okay, that's fine. Yep. Just one last question is that from the term that emergent design that we had, right? A lot of references which we have been speaking so far is 2006, 2005, and all of those years, so almost 5-8 years back. So what is latest? Is there anything which is happening in the latest trend, say about 2 years back or something, towards the emergent design?
Latest trends around that? That's what I'm trying to determine right now. In fact, what I'm doing right now, one of the things I'm doing at ThoughtWorks is actually going and visiting ThoughtWorks projects all over the world and see how they've applied evolutionary architecture and emergent design. I'm going to try to consolidate all that stuff, and that's going to be my next book. Probably next year.
All right. Then we'll meet you next year for that. Thanks.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I have a doubt. When you're talking about the unit test, we have the 100% unit coverage. And when it comes to integration, when it comes to a kind of a functional end-to-end test, like the coverage tends to be low because the cost of maintaining all those things will be. What would be the ideal combination? Because I often enter into a situation, I used to follow TDD, but when it comes to integration, there's some things, because when I'm doing the unit test,
Look at code coverage past unit test because it's irrelevant.
Okay.
There's no way you can get 100% test coverage on a functional test without doing a ridiculous amount of not very high value effort.
Yeah.
So I care about code coverage on unit test. I don't even look at it higher than that, functional or integration test. Because that's more driven by business functionality than, you know, making sure you've gone through down every path.
Okay. What is the combination? When we are doing the unit test, we have this something like 100% unit coverage or something like that. Mm-hmm. But when it comes to integration and when it comes to BDD, it's kind of a vague, like how much coverage that I need to offer. And
zero. I don't care. It's irrelevant.
Okay.
It doesn't tell me something valuable. I mean, it probably would if I took the effort to actually make it work, but having tried this years and years ago, it is nowhere near the effort to get 100% coverage on functional tests. Because it's just too hard at that high a coarse grain level to get down every path. You end up doing crazy things. So don't even worry about it past unit tests.
Okay.
The only reason you care about code coverage on unit tests is to make sure that every path has been taken in your unit code. Well, if you've got that covered, then the functional stuff should better.
And another thing is when I was doing the mocking and all, like, people used to more trust on integration test rather than on a unit test. Like when we are saying mock, why don't you integrate with the database and write the integration test? Like, what is the thought process on that? Like, the integration test is something which is very critical.
Depends on what you're writing. So typically we like the Mike Cohn testing pyramid where most of your tests are unit tests and the next most are functional tests and the top one are user acceptance kind of tests. Integration tests for us would probably be in the flavor of a functional test because we want to make sure all the pieces fit together. But it really depends on what you're doing. And so, if you have a code base that has a lot of very, very complex business rules, you're going to have a big fat set of functional tests to make sure all those work. Whereas if you've got a CRUD application, you'll have virtually no functional tests because it's CRUD. It's very easy to verify that things got stuck in the database, so we're all done.
Okay.
So I think it's more domain-driven than anything else. Yes?
Neil, you talked about pushing things from the architecture layer to the design layer as far as possible.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, convert things which traditionally are thought of as architecture into something which can be swapped.
Yep, if you can.
Do you have any guidelines for that, or any books or any references that we can refer to?
It's brand new. This really ties, and Rebecca's going to talk on this some too. The kind of inspiration for this really comes from the continuous delivery space, which is thinking about component-based architectures. And there seems to be big trend happening in the world right now that everybody's going to microservices architectures because it's just easier. It's just easier to deal with. It's easier to integrate. Everybody's going to microservice REST-based architectures where you build lots of very small REST-based things that each own their own data. You integrate between those things with other small REST-based services. And what you're doing is creating those as components. And if you have nice semantic interfaces for those components, it's relatively easy to swap the implementation out for that and put another one in place. So you basically turn that into a design element by converting it into a component. So this is literally, I think, on the cutting edge of our thinking about software in the agile space right now and architecture. And continuous delivery has kind of started that, and then I'm kind of trying to continue this, the R&D effort. So like I said at the beginning of the talk, I think this is the most fascinating thing that's happening in the engineering space in agile right now. And I'm really keen to dig more into it to see what else is there. So his question is, will some elements never move to the design space? Absolutely. In fact, in my rampant emergence talk, I basically said, if you've done a really good job of creating a component-based system and the product guy wants to pivot some behavior to something else, if you're lucky, you have an architectural element that you can just replace and give you that new functionality and everything's good. But you're never going to be that lucky. There's all your product person, your business analyst is always going to find something that slices through your architectural layers in awful ways. But there are ways to do that too. You can do feature toggles, you can do branch by abstraction. So there are ways that don't affect the architecture that you can still support those kind of behaviors.
My question is related to non-functional requirements. You talked a lot about structural aspects, mm-hmm. and you talked about a lot about functionality, how to realize functionality, you know, mm-hmm. and make a decision when a point is in the last moment possible mm-hmm. on design decisions. So as you know, lots of projects fail because they fail to meet non-functional requirements like scalability, performance, mm-hmm. etc. So and many of the architectural decisions are taken because of NFR requirements. So when we don't, my question is, how do we handle NFRs in the context of evolutionary architecture and emergent design?
So it's a very good question. His question is, how do we take care of things like scalability and non-functional requirements if you're doing evolutionary architecture? Notice I'm not saying no architecture. So very, very much up front, we will find out from the client or the users or whatever, what is the expected scale, what is the expected response time here, and we will actually add fitness functions into the code base pretty much before we've written any code whatsoever, just to do some very coarse grain. So if we have a hard requirement that every page must load in less than a second, we'll put a test in day one that says for every page that loads, make sure it loads in less than a second and fail a test if it doesn't. So we can find out right away, not 6 months down the road, that something's happened. And what we tend to do in that case is we put I hate the term non-functional requirements because if they're non-functional, why are they there? I like quality of service better because that's really what it is. So what we do is we put quality of service stuff kind of stubs in early on, and then as we get closer to release, we add more and more resources to that to make sure that we've got good coverage and we understand the architectural elements. And so we pay attention to that all along the way. We don't try to wait until the very end and then try to retrofit it because you can't. It's architectural. Things like scalability and stuff like that are architectural. You want to put a small piece in now and let it evolve over time. That's the ideal.
I'm asking about a specific example. We know the requirement. I mean, for example, 1 second for page load. Mm-hmm. Then we could be able to make a design decision or architectural decision. Yep. But often in most of the cases, particularly when the requirements evolve, we do not know the NFR requirements.
As a business person, you can't ask me to predict the future or to do magic things. You got to tell me up front because it's engineering. I can't make magic things happen after the fact unless you want to give me time. So there are certainly cases where you start something that's very small and it reaches a point where it can't scale anymore. Then that's a rewrite. But that's not the fault of evolutionary architecture. You need to know up front some of these things. I mean, this is the scientific method. We need to be able to experiment and get results back. And if a business person comes to me and says, I need an application, but I don't know what kind of scale it's going to need, but I know it's going to be really important, I'm going to call bullshit on that. I'm going to say, I'm not going to write any software for you until you can give me some concrete numbers that I can actually test against. I want the ability to have objective measures for things. So that's what I would do there. I would push back on the, well, let's just build something simple and then we'll make it scale later. That's not a good solution. Unless you want to say, okay, well, let's reserve a bunch of time to rewrite it once it hits a certain point and we'll retrofit it with something else. Other questions? Yes.
Okay. You explained idiomatic patterns, which we generally apply on projects which may not applicable to other projects. So you gave example of annotations. So annotations is a one type of idiomatic pattern?
So validation, yes.
Sorry?
What was the question about validations?
Annotation-based example, you gave annotation-based example.
Yes.
So annotation is a one type of idiomatic pattern. I mean, there is other ways to, you know, pattern is generally a problem and their solution.
Yep. So the only two that I specifically call out here are APIs and annotations. There are probably some others, certainly depending on language, but those two are pretty language agnostic, so that's why I stuck with those two.
Okay. Thanks.
Yes. And I didn't touch at all on idiomatic patterns at the domain level, but domain-specific languages are fantastic for that because that allows you to capture important things about the business in a language very close to the business and capture those in DSLs, and that becomes a really good way to harvest business-level idiomatic patterns. But I don't have time to talk about that. Yeah.
Again, going back to handling complexity, you were talking about writing functionality and handling errors, for example, exceptions, and so on. You always end up seeing in code a lot of exception handling than building functionality. And of course, you can abstract a bit and so on. But have you seen any adaptation of formal methods where you have these preconditions, postconditions, and invariants?
Have I seen formal methods for?
For handling complexity or like error conditions even before you enter a method. So for example, using
preconditions or something
preconditions,
like that.
Preconditions, yeah. Postconditions, and
some languages support that natively. Scala, for example, has a really nice require precondition kind of library. There's some code in the Ruby world too called Handshake that lets you set Eiffel style pre and post conditions for methods. So that's certainly a perfectly legitimate thing. The thing you have to watch out for is make sure that those assumptions are always going to be true, because you might find yourself putting too much rigor in there and then having to go back and take it out later. There's nothing wrong with that.
What is the latest thinking, at least in Java, with respect to checked and unchecked exceptions?
Forget checked exceptions. What a horrible, horrible, horrible idea. If you look at every single language that's coming after Java, they all swallow checked exceptions and turn them into runtime exceptions. So almost universally, not universally, but almost universally, checked exceptions were a terrible idea. So just convert them all to runtime exceptions and forget about that stupid signature because it doesn't help anything. It's one of those things that sounded like a great idea, and then in practice it becomes this really horrible, cumbersome thing. And you can look at every language that's come since on the JVM. None of them have checked exceptions. In fact, mark my words, no language ever in the future will have checked exceptions. It was such a terrible idea, nobody's going to do it again, I think. Now, Mike Nygaard will argue with me about that. He wrote Release It, and he's big in the DevOps space, and so he has cases where a checked exception actually solved them a problem, but I say that if you have checked exceptions and it causes 1,000 problems and solves one, then I'd rather get rid of 1,000 problems and deal with the other one problem in a different way.
Your suggestions in order to drive the quantification or the significance of TDD to the management or the team, can you suggest as to how we can drive the advantages or the significance we get to the senior management and to the developers?
So here's the ironic thing. So a lot of times people ask me, okay, I understand that testing is a good thing. How much extra time do you budget on your project to do all this unit testing? Is it 10%? Is it 15%? Turns out it's 0% because it actually allows you to go faster. People who believe that testing slow you down believe that there's a correlation between typing speed and developer productivity. And that is a really loose correlation, if at all. It really has nothing to do with the number of lines of code you type. So a great example of this is a study done by a doctor in the U.S., Dr. Lori Williams from University of Carolina, where she did an experiment. She took a group of inexperienced developers, college students, and a group of experienced developers, and had them do a two-month project. And the only difference was she got the inexperienced developers to do TDD, and the experienced developers just wrote code. So not surprisingly, experienced developers got out to an early lead, but by the end of 2 months, both teams had implemented essentially the same amount of functionality, and the less experienced TDD team had 50% fewer bugs than the experienced developers. It does not slow you down. It speeds you up, because you know what you don't spend time doing in a TDD code base? Single stepping through the debugger. You almost never debug stuff in TDD because you've resolved all those things with tests before you have to debug it. There was a company called Sixth Sense who wrote this tool that's kind of slightly evil that actually monitored what users did in their IDE all day. And it was fascinating because they found that teams that did TDD spent an order of magnitude less time in the debugger than teams that didn't do TDD. So that's the trade-off, spending a lot less time debugging, and I'm actually writing code that we can now regression test, because debugging isn't regressionable, but unit tests are.
So it definitely makes sense to use TDD for new code that you're writing, right? But you know, we have a lot of legacy code in our system.
Mm-hmm.
Code was written like 10 years ago. It was not very well written, like very testable.
Yep.
So does it make sense to go back and write unit tests for those things?
Here's what I would do.
A lot of effort.
No, it's not worth the effort. Here's what I would do. The goal of unit tests in a brownfield project is to, so what I would do is start a new policy saying starting next Monday, our code coverage will always get higher. So it's zero right now. I'll write a unit test on Monday and that'll be 0.00000001%, which is higher than zero. So that's good. And what you do is every time you add new behavior, you write a test, and every time you fix a bug, you write a test. Because what you want to do is put tests around the most fragile parts of that existing code base, which is where there are bugs and where you're adding stuff. So you'll never get to 100%, but it'll always get higher from this point on, and that shows you you're doing the best thing you can do against that aging code base to get confidence in the things that are broken and the things you're adding. I think that's the best use of tests.
Even to add unit tests to existing code, would it make sense to just rewrite some parts of it to make it more testable?
Certainly. So the probably the big exception to that rule is you encounter a 200-line method, and you need to add some functionality to it. Nobody wants to deal with that. So typically what I would do in that case is write a very coarse-grained functional test that just looks at the overall state transition for that giant method. Now I have a safety net. Now I'll rip that thing apart and put it into smaller methods. I can still make sure it does what it's supposed to do. Now, once I get to smaller methods, now I can add new functionality and write some unit tests around those. So I would opportunistically break down big ugly things as you need to start working on them. But the big ugly things that are there, they're not broken. Just leave them there until we have to touch them. And we have to touch them, then start doing some reactive refactoring on it. Yes?
Task.
Mm-hmm.
How can you address that issue?
There are some tools out there that work variously well to do that, but that's really just got to be more an intelligent developer going through. And you know, if you've got really good unit tests, it's easy to tell, but it's hard if you don't. So, I mean, the best thing to do is really optimize your build and go in and remove methods and try to build and see what happens. That's about the best you can do without specific tooling around a particular language or IDE. Yep.
Hi, Neil. First of all, thanks for the fantastic session. It's really informative.
Can you speak up? I can.
Yeah. First of all, thanks for a fantastic session. It was really informative.
Thanks.
One of the practical problems that we are facing currently is like we are like five to 6 months into the development, so it's not yet generally available outside in the market, but we are still in the development.
Speak up. I can barely hear you.
We are still in the development phase, so we are 5 to 6 months into the development.
Mm-hmm.
So. Now we are planning to adopt, TDD.
Mm-hmm.
So basically the question is like, so we have a code base where we have, followed test after methodology. Mm-hmm. We have unit tests. We have some amount of coverage, 50-60%.
Yep.
But it's not done in a TDD way.
That's okay.
So as you said, our cyclomatic complexity is all, well beyond 10. So.
Good.
So that's the stage where we are in.
Mm-hmm.
Now the problem, practical problem that we are facing is now if we want to adopt TDD, Okay, so how to do it, you know, for the already existing methods which are
well, don't worry about the existing unit tests. I mean, so when you do TDD, when you're done, the cool side effect is you have a bunch of tests. Well, you've already got those. So you've already kind of done the design for those. So I wouldn't worry about those. Just start doing TDD for the new stuff. You may find design elements you want to change later, but I wouldn't go back and revisit all those. I just leave those unit tests in place and go from here forward and do TDD and then retrofit things that you find that are maybe accidentally broken. I don't think there's huge value, especially if you've already got tests. In fact, there's no value in going back and TDDing it just for the sake of TDDing it. The design flaws you'll find will probably be so minor it would be nowhere near the effort required to go do that.
So basically even the next 2-3 months, even if say, suppose there are 100 methods now, so at least 50 methods we are going to change. So
I would pick a date. Starting next Tuesday, everything is going to be TDD. Done.
So that's what the major thing is, like for these 50 methods, even if you want to go ahead with the TDD way or not, or for the new methods that we write, it's better to approach,
I'm a big fan of TDD because it gives you two benefits. It gives you a regressionable test, and it tells you something about the code you're writing right now. So that's why I love TDD as a design practice.
Thank you.
Okay, I want to take one more question because we're now officially half an hour after the session. I appreciate you guys hanging around.
I need, my question is, where do I draw a line saying what is architecture and what can go into emergent design?
So the question is, are you hard to change later?
Yeah.
Than your architecture.
Okay.
So what are you curious about? Your rules engine, that's architecture. It's hard to change later. Your web frameworks, architecture. Your database, architecture. Language, architecture. How you use those things is usually design.
Okay, you're saying the much harder to change is probably going to architecture.
Much harder to change architecture because it's the things that are hard to change later. They're the bedrock things that you've made assumptions about. Because architecture gives you two things. It gives you scaffolding so that you don't have to write a bunch of stuff. But it also gives you constraints. And so it's important to understand both sides of that, that you're getting constraints and benefits, and trade those things off.
Thank you.
Okay, well, I want you guys to get some lunch, and there's only half an hour left in lunch, so thanks very much for coming. I hope you enjoyed it. Thanks.